Everyone, teachers and students alike. Today I welcome you to this webinar series with our Vice Chancellor sir as the main speaker. Before we begin, I would like to give some instructions. Firstly, let's not have any audio or videos on by any of the participants. After the talk, we are going to have a question and answer session. Any questions, please post it in the Q&A provided in your in the interface. After the talk is over, we'll take some of those questions, and that is the itinerary for today. Okay, welcome all. Today we tackle the question: what is success? What makes one successful? What is the path to success? This has been an ongoing existential debate since time immemorial. Today I have the privilege to introduce a most apt speaker to enlighten us on this topic, path to success. Professor Dr. S.P. Singh has been integral to the Royal Group since its inception in 2009, when he was the founder director of the institution. He then moved on to Amity Educational Group in 2013. Where he joined as the Senior Vice President Academic of the group and was responsible for the functioning of 6 Amity campuses situated in different parts of the country as well as abroad. He also served as the founding Vice Chancellor of Amity University, Chhattisgarh, for almost 2 years before joining the Assam Royal Global University in November 2016 as the founding Vice Chancellor. So all in all, we have a great administrator who has had over 20 years of headship in well-known academic institutions across the country. However, that is not all. Excuse me. Professor Singh is also an academician. Even though he cleared his UPSC service exam, he decided to go with his heart and continue on a career of teaching. And ever since, he has had 2 NET qualifications. He's someone who follows his heart and in fact backs it up with sheer willpower and guts. He's a geologist, he is an MBA and a law graduate, and he has a PhD in strategic management. With a background, academic background such as this, it's no wonder that in our university, we have an innovative course structure. Students, you will experience set course structure as your days continue on with RGU. Professor Singh is also an ardent sports lover, being a baseball player himself, and his energy is contagious, even at the workplace where he is always working. He practices, it's a cliche, but I can assure you that he practices what he preaches. So, sir, I leave this virtual floor to you, please, sir.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sam. This is almost 1:20, and initially, when the last webinar was getting over, session was getting over, some of the students were there, and I thought my session is scheduled from 1:30, so I told them to join at 1:30. So it's quite likely that some of the students might join a little late. So my humble request to all head of the departments, and Sam, you can pass this message to the head of departments to request the students to join early if they have not joined so far. So therefore, I will a little bit delay my discussion, or maybe I will not come to the topic directly. As of now, I will take another 5-10 minutes to tell you something about path to success, but something which probably is very important for all of you to understand, and also to talk about what we have discussed today in last 2 webinars, and also what we discussed yesterday and day before yesterday. I would like to appreciate the organizers of the orientation program. And I would say that you students are very, very fortunate that this time, because of tough time, because of difficult times, because of pandemic, because of corona, we are interacting with you on a digital platform. Though I'm missing all of you very badly in this campus, and I think the vibes you bring to the campus in form of your positivity that has been badly missed by this brick and mortar university, because this university is university only when we have faculty and students all enjoying this infrastructure, learning, understanding, making friends, socializing, and also learning for life. But that part has been missed as of now because of this pandemic. But I'm very sure in another 1 month or so, or maybe less than that, we all are going to be under the same roof, maybe with little social distancing, maybe in a format which is hybrid in nature, which is something which is probably require half of you to attend the classes physically and half of you attending from home. And next day, half of you will come to the university and half of you at home, or maybe any other method. Maybe you'll come in the morning and afternoon you will attend from home. So some kind of way out will be there. But I really am eager to see all of you in the campus. So this way I have increased the number of participants to 260 now, but still number are quite less. This is in front of me. So further, I mean, I just like to say about the National Education Policy, about ABC and other things, what Pankaj Mittal has talked in the morning, and about what Dr. Himanshu Rai has spoken today. They both were very, very eloquent speakers and very good deliberation. And I think I'm very sure that many of you have not only jotted down things, what you have liked, but also you have learned and you will follow and you will practice many such ideas, many such messages, many such things which you think is right and good for your perspective. At Royal Global University, I would say that all of you, please visit our website, thoroughly read each and every word which is written there. The prospectus you might have taken from the campus, or maybe it has been sent to you online. If at all you have not received the prospectus online, or neither you have taken the printed prospectus from the campus at the time of purchasing the form, please ask it from the admission section and read it thoroughly. Why I want you to read it thoroughly, not only your area, what you'll do, you'll just see the page which concerns you, your course, your program, what you're doing, but that is not good enough. I request you to go through each and every page, try to find out who is our chancellor, try to find out who is our vice pro chancellor, also about advisor, about vice chancellor, about chairperson academics, and also try to learn more from other sources means that maybe. Websites, that may be some kind of material which is available there on YouTube, or something is available there on www World Wide Web about the institution, about the university, and about the people who are working with this university. Also, you need to know something about your teachers who are going to teach you this orientation program. You are interacting with your teachers in the afternoon session most of the days, so I hope you will be able to interact with all of them. Please try to know more about them. Also, please try to find out the courses which have been offered in different semesters, about the credit system, what Dr. Pankaj Mittal has studied categorically. Maybe whatever credits you will earn today, if somehow you are not been able to continue next year or next to next year, it is quite likely that this university will also decide that we will give you a credit card that you already have covered these credit, you can put up that particular thing in the credit bank. So all those things are there, and you can do many other things along with what your undergraduate program, what you're going to follow in Royal Global University. For that, I think you need to be in touch with the right kind of people, including your teachers, who can guide you in that direction. And if nobody is able to guide you, then we have mentor-mentee system in the campus, where mentors will guide you, and also the teacher mentor can also further guide you so that you can do more if you have strength and willpower to do more. But I would suggest you in the very beginning that most of you, please try to concentrate on the on the course and the syllabus and whatever is to be offered in the first semester. Because it is a new form of education for you, because it is a digital mode. So some of you will face some issues with respect to understanding, with respect to hearing voice clearly, with respect to course material, with respect to lesson plans, with respect to some portion of the course which actually require face-to-face interaction. We might do it in a virtual platform by simulation. So all those things, and some of the things if we'll not be able to do this time, I assure you that we will try to compensate in coming semester. That may be some practical classes, that may be something which require your physical presence. So if at all you are not been able to come for 1 month or 1.5 month, whatever time, I assure you, you will not miss anything. We'll try to cover everything to the best possible way in this semester, coming next semester, or maybe next year. But we will not let you go without completing the whole syllabus or every practical aspect of the syllabus, which actually require your physical presence. So don't worry much, number one. Now I think it's almost time, and we have almost 350 participants now. So I would come to the topic. The topic is path to success. And as Dr. Samuel has said, that success is a very controversial topic. I would say for everybody, the meaning of success is different. What is success for a farmer who is there in one of the villages in Nagaon? And what is the success for somebody who is into a small primary school in Golaghat? Success for somebody who is a homemaker, who doesn't work, a lady, your mother, my mother, who are working at home for the happiness of all of us. Success for those who are working in the field, earning their livelihood, and end of the day, they are feeding their children well. Success for those people who are into living in cities or maybe suburban area, doing some kind of productive work. That may be a small shop, that may be a small business, that may be other small engagement, and having less income, living in a very small place, but they are also successful in their own way. So for them, success will be different. For people like us who are working in Royal Global University, working as assistant professor, professor, manager, vice chancellor, what is our thinking of success? How we think we are successful or failure? Success as a student, many of you have raised question, is marks a success? Is earning a lot of money a success? Is your passion when fulfilled and you feel satisfied end of the day, you sleep well? That as Dr. Rai said, and I always say, is that a success? Once you are grown up, if your children are successful, is that your success? Once your children get success, is your grandchildren successful? Is that a success? If you have one house, you have three more houses, is that success? If you are driving Ferrari, is that a success? If you are chief minister of a state, is that a success? Or if you are prime minister of India, is that a success? So I'm just telling you each and every stage, each and every strata of the society. For everyone, success is different. At the same time, in your life span, I mean from your childhood to the time when you go finally to rest and you leave this world, for every minute maybe, but for every day, there is something which is success, it is something which is a failure. On monthly basis, there is a success and failure. Yearly basis, there is a success and failure. And then there is a long-term success and there is a lifelong success. So this is also different start of success. Some people at your stage, at the stage of a student, will be successful by achieving very good grades. some people will be very successful once they achieve something more than grades. And the time has come, and I think somebody has raised this question also. I will try to touch upon that. That many a times your grade doesn't matter, but many a times, like Dr. Himanshu Rai said, for the screening purpose, your grade matters. But everyone wants somebody who is not only having right grades, but also having right kind of attitude, right kind of motivation, right kind of mindset, right kind of vibes, right kind of aura, right kind of inclination for life, and right kind of happiness. Who gets happiness from right things are right kind of happiness. Who get temporary happiness from wrong things is wrong happiness. Happiness can also be right and wrong. Success can also be right and wrong. Success, somebody thinks that he has troubled somebody and he was planning to trouble somebody from a long time, and today I'm able to trouble that person, for somebody that can also be success, but that would be the right success. So we have to define success. We have to define. So it is a very, very complex phenomena. So therefore, path to success, I'm talking about path to your success at your point of time, at your stage in life, and it is different for different people at that stage of life, depending upon socio-cultural economic background they are coming from, and also the type of inputs they have given in their life during last 17, 18 years of your age. Most of you are either 17, 18 or 19 years of age, so I presume, other than exceptionally one or two, maybe 20 or 21. So if altogether by 900, 1000 students who have joined Royal Global University in the undergraduate program, I would say for everyone, success is different. Many times, what you think is success is what you want to achieve for your parents. Many times, what you think is success is what you want to achieve for yourself at this point of time. And many times, what you think is success, what you presume what you will be after some point of time from now. So I'm not complicating, I'm making it very simple for all of you, the definition of success, short-term success and long-term success. So this is what I will try to tell you something about, I may be excused, something from my life. I have many, many failures in my life. And every time I failed, at that point of time, I felt I failed. But then I realized after some time, but that failure was my success. So failure can also be a success. I'm not talking about failing in the exam. I'm not talking about failing in a particular venture in your life. Every time you try to do something, there are two outcomes. I'm interacting with you, deliberating upon, end of the day, when this particular session will be over, either I will think that I got successful in sending my message across my student and they are happy to understand something from me as a vice chancellor, or I will think that I've not been able to deliberate upon well, I'm having little success, or I'm a failure for today's session. So this is there in my mind at the time when I started speaking with you. But it does not and should not hamper my inclination and motivation to become successful end of this session. So that is my temporary, short-lived success understanding. Same way, when in life, when I, as Dr. Rai said, or maybe I would also try to find out from what Dr. Pankaj Mittal has said, that many times in life when we were young, very young, that time our little success was very painful. Little success was very happiness. A little failure was painful because our understanding for life was very limited. I mean, if you're trying to earn a penny from your mother or father to purchase something what you like the most, that may be a chocolate, that may be anything. And if you used to pursue them well and succeed them in getting that small amount of 5, 10 rupees at my age, or maybe 1 or 2 rupees at my age and 5, 10, 20 rupees at your age, that used to be a success if you achieve it, and that used to be a failure if you don't get it. And that point of time from 5 years to 15 years or 13 years, that small failures were at times very long lasting failures in our life because our understanding for success and failure was very limited. But when we have grown up, we have come to a school life, when we reach to class 9, 10th, 11, 12th, we become little mature and we started taking failures easily and we started normalizing our success in a very moderate manner. We also have learned that the failure is not going to be everlasting and the success is also not going to be everlasting. Success will remain success for some time. Unless until you go for the next level of success, this success will have no meaning. The same way the failures which are failure today, if you will work hard tomorrow, those failures will become success in due course of time. So this is what I learned from my earlier age when I was 5-6 years of age till whatever I am today, 53 years of age. I tell you, for me, I'm just sharing a very simple thing. Maybe some of you who are doing this or who have done that probably will understand that. I belong to a family, very humble background, and from a family where the woman of the house used to be in a parda. You know the parda, they were not been allowed to go out to do day-to-day purchasing. My mother especially, I have been groomed under the supervision of my grandfather. I was having a weekend grandfather. He used to come only on the weekends. My grandfather and my mother. And my mother was not allowed to come in front of the grandfather. And neither she was allowed to go out to purchase anything from the market in general, unless and until it is an occasion to go and purchase something. So all daily activities, daily purchasing, routine purchases of vegetable, milk, whatever is required in a family you can think of. I was blessed, I would say that. That particular disguise to my maybe mother of parda, but was a blessing for me. When I was in class 4, maybe of 8 or 9 years of age, the whole responsibility has fallen on my shoulder. But I always have taken that particular responsibility when I was in class 4 to enjoy whatever I was doing at that point of time. And when my children grown up, I have also told them to do the same thing because I have learned so many things by doing such small things at that point of time in my life. By purchasing potatoes or tomato or onion or maybe milk or whatever. I know at this point of time that becomes very handy to me. My passion for, you know, quality, my passion for quality purchase has become also quality for my life also. And whenever I work anywhere. So what I wanted to probably say at that point of time, that was not a misery for me. I have taken it as a success that I was so confident and confident to more, I mean, to such people who are far elder than me at that point of time in age, but I was more prudent, more proficient, and more intelligent, and more, I would say, systematic, and having good negotiation skill to purchase good things at a reasonably good price. So that was my learning. So what I probably said, that was my success. Same way in life also, whenever I got an opportunity, I tried to grab that opportunity to learn something and get a small happiness, what you can say success from there. And that has bring me here to this level of success in my life. And I still foresee this is what I've achieved in my life. It's hardly 1/3 or maybe 1/4 of my achievement. I may achieve more in my life if God will keep blessing me and I will keep working hard. So this is one part which I wanted to share, that whenever any opportunity comes to you, whenever your parents ask you to do something, whenever your elders ask you to do something, whenever in Royal Global University your teachers ask to do something beyond what is to be taught in the class and what you need to study to fetch marks, please take it as it, as this is an opportunity God gives to you to give you a chance to learn more. And that is will be the first path to success. And those small success, what you will achieve by doing something extra, will help you to become more successful in life, more contented in life, more stress-free in life. People who work a lot, I would say people who work double than normal, they have less stress than people who work normal but not with happiness. The stress has direct bearing on the success and happiness. Every little success will motivate you for the next step, and every next success will motivate you for the next step, and that is the way life goes on. And every time when you achieve something, never ever think that you have achieved something extraordinary. That always become, every success become ordinary after some span of time. As a vice chancellor, this is my second tenure, but now I feel this is enough, not with respect to the vice chancellor, but my success as a vice chancellor at this level. Unless and until I do something more for this university, unless and until my students, most of them, all of them get success in life, I feel that sitting on this chair is not enough unless and until you all get success. So I have raised my bar of success. I have raised my bar of success for the next level of success that is directly proportional to your success. So this is what is required at every level. When you achieve a particular level of success, think something bigger, not only in terms of marks, as I'm repeating again and again, but also in terms of life, what makes you happy and what you think is the success for you. If I talk about success, there should be some ways to achieve it and how you can tackle failure to become successful. And I want to just tell you one story of the failure which has made me more successful in my life. That when I was in class 10th or 9th or 10th, I remember, we used to appear in the New Education Policy, it is there, and we got a chance to get the to appear in the board examination, like we have 10th board and 12th board at our time in our UP board, Uttar Pradesh board, from where I studied my initial schooling and years. Class 8th used to be a board examination, and we never knew what board is. Class 8, I was hardly 8 and 4, 12 years of age. At the age of 12, board examination, going to another center, appear in the exam, prepare for the exam, there used to be a merit list and whatnot. So in class 8th, I remember I've been exposed to board examination, and without any fear or pressure, it's the normal examination, I appeared in the exam and I could find a rank in class 8th board examination. But then I thought, and that time it was a regional, I mean, it was not the state, the region wise merit list used to be prepared. So in my region, I got a chance to be appeared in. But I never thought at that point of time that I am intelligent enough to be figured in that particular, but my teachers were confident about me. So they appreciated my effort, and I also found it very good. But then failure, what I want to tell you, at that point of time, I have never decided to fetch more marks in my next exam. This I'm telling to many students who are not running after marks. You should run after marks to an extent, but in the name of running after marks, if you lose everything else, this is not advisable. That won't be a path to success. If you can achieve the highest of the marks, and along with that, you achieve all other things which is required to become a wholesome personality, become multifaceted, then it is fine. You are extraordinary. Kudos to you. God bless you. And you can do it. Many of my friends have done it. So if you can fetch both, you can be topper in the class, as well as topper in the sports, as well as topper in the athletics, also a very good debatist, also a very good negotiator, also a very good human being, also a person who can socialize the most, also a person who can have best of the friends, you are blessed. But not everybody is so blessed. Therefore, you have to understand, have to maintain a balance between your success, little success, success in different fields, and achievements in life. So what I was telling you, after class 8th, I decided that I will study, but I will not study as much as I studied in class 8th. It's very surprising. I'm confessing in front of you. That has given me a jolt also, that I will also share with you, because my life is altogether open. I will share that with you also. But in class 8th, when I was for the board examination of class 10th, I have read a lot, I prepared a lot, but at the same time, I decided to start my journey of sports and I wanted to be more athletic. I wanted to be more fit. I wanted to be more healthier. And I wanted to be more known in the field of sports. And God was very kind. I represented five of my school teams. Not baseball was not there, which I learned when I joined the university. But I was in the football team of the school. I was in the cricket team of the school. I was in the volleyball team of the school. I was in the hockey team of the school. And I was also there in the squash team of the school. Not badminton, squash. We were having a squash court also. So five school teams. And then in class 10th also, I could do pretty well. And I scored in my board examination point of view. When the merit used to be in our time, the merit list used to be at the 80%, 81%. I scored 72%. And that was quite good marks at that point of time. And I was ranked in my school 4th or 5th. But then my passion has become more for sports, more for extracurricular activities, more for leadership, more for college captainship, more for your club captainship. So I became senior house prefect for my house. My house was Ajanta House, yellow color, I remember. So Ajanta House, I became senior house prefect and I was contender for the college captain. And college captain for my school, Kolwin Talukedars, used to be a big thing. My junior, Mr. Harmeet Singh, who is the ADGP of Assam, became college captain after 1 year from the time when I pass out. So he's from my school. So what I'm saying is school was great. And I continue represented my five college teams in my class 12th, 11th also. But somehow I could not do much for studies in class 11th and 12th. And God probably has also given me a little punishment. I would say that at point of time, I fall sick at the time of my exam. And it was not a normal sickness. I got sick with typhoid. And typhoid continued for 1.5 months. And I remember I used to take two very, very important medicines. You might be knowing metacin, everybody knows. It is for fever. But the second was very deadly, a small tablet called Delta Cartel. And Delta Cartel now has been banned in the world. And Delta Cartel is known for its after side effects of damaging your liver. So just after this exam, which I appeared with the high fever, and in one of the exam, I slept in between while I was writing the exam. The invigilator woke me up and asked me to write the exam again. I could pass with good percentage of marks, but I would say in comparison to class 10th, it was bad. That was the only time in my life I got second division. And I share with you, it is not only because of my sickness, because of my illness. It was cumulative because I was not concentrating enough during my class 11th and 12th. I was more into other areas, other things. That is also helping me a lot at this point of time. But then it has happened. And it was a big shock. I never thought that I will be getting the second division. But then I got it. And I think I got admission in my University of Lucknow. I think I was maybe last or last but one admission list. Otherwise, I could have missed Lucknow University. I could be studying in any of the colleges. But fortunately, I got admission. But then the life has changed. Why I'm sharing with you this? Because everybody shares success. As a vice chancellor, I need to share my failures also to you. Because many of you I know could not do well in your class 12. But if you could not do well in your class 12th, I have seen the admission list. I have seen the average percentage of marks of some of you. And probably I know each and every class, what is the average student who have joined in. So all those dear friends, I say today, friends, tomorrow you are joining physically, you are going to be my students. And once you pass out, definitely you are my friends. So dear students, I would say that if you got less marks in class 12th, and you could not do something in your life at this point of time. And if you have realized what are the reasons why you could not score well in class 12th, this is the time and opportunity you can do better the way I did in my life from then onwards. That was my first and last, I would say, mistake, failure, whatever you name it. I have still not been able to convince myself that why that happened to me, but that happened. But then I knew at that point of time that my energies are going in different directions. So if in your class 11, 12th or 9, 10th, if you could not score well, but you have devoted your energy in the right manner, in the right direction to achieve something equally good, that may be in the field of sports, that may be in the field of reading, that may be in the field of music, dance, or anything in addition to marks, if you have done, which is good in the life, in the coming life, or maybe is going to be useful in the due course of time in your life, I think you are not a failure. I never found myself a failure, even if I fit second division in my class. So my dear friends who could not score well, nowadays second division is, in our time we used to say, good second. You know, if you have just missed first division by few marks, it was called good second. So I was having not second division, I was having good second division. I missed by few marks only the first division because of my subject, which probably I never liked, chemistry. So then, but then I had to read geochemistry when I taken geology. So, I mean, you have to at times learn many things which you don't like, not for fetching the marks, but also to gradually become happy for that subject. And that I gradually have done with chemistry. And I know more chemistry than I was trying to learn when I was in class 11. So I deliberately have thought that I will share this story with you all today, because today I got more time than normally when we have orientation program. I used to get hardly 10, 15 minutes to speak with you, but today I wanted to share many, many things with you. I think I'm very fortunate that I'm able to share all these things with you, but I think you are equally fortunate that you will learn something from my life. So when I reached university and I got a chance to take admission in BSc, and then many 5 subjects became 3 subjects, and that's zoology, botany, and geology. And then I thought again that now I will make a better balance than I used to have in class 11, 12. 10th was a good balance, but 11, 12, I somehow could not maintain the balance. And that balance for success, I could maintain well. And since then, till date, I'm maintaining that balance. Why I'm maintaining that balance? Because I really want to be successful, not only successful with respect to my profession, but I wanted to be successful in life. And what is successful in life at my age, as I said, is different. For you, it is different. Small success make a bigger success. So please be prepared for small success so that you enjoy that success and be motivated for the next level of success. Now, I like to tell you a few very sensitive but important part of your life with respect to your behavior and attitude that probably will help you to become more successful as one, but also to be more happier. You know, at times when people are mostly happy, people don't take them seriously. You know, every time if I keep on making my face always looks that I'm in a great tension or always thinking something. A vice chancellor can never be a happy person. And vice chancellors are always, you know, a grim face and always under pressure. I think most of them whom I know as a vice chancellor who are not happy are pseudo people. Pseudo means there's nobody on this earth can live for long without happiness. But once you are happy at home, once you are happy out of your workplace and you make a grim face while you are working, it is a pseudo face. And those kind of people are not, I'm talking about only vice chancellor, I'm talking about all those teachers who are attending the webinar also, and all those students who are attending the webinar or maybe this session today, that if you deliberately keep a straight face, long face, grim face, even if you are happy, you are not a good person from heart. You are having a dual personality or split personality disorder, and you are trying to face your real self. At times it is required temporarily, because you know you have to deal with many people in this life. You have to deal with different kind of people every day. At times your happiness, your smile, your vibrancy may create problems for you. I'm talking about awkward situations. So at that point of time, as a human, you have to make faces. Even animals make faces. So humans are all have authority to make faces at that point of time. But that face should not become a permanent face of yours in due course of time. But many people I know who face regular issues with respect to people around. And if you have many people, negative people around you, and everyone in your family, everyone in your surrounding is having a long face, always unnecessarily stressed and unnecessary under tension. And there's a lot of tension going on in your family because not all families are healthy families. The tension is going on in your family. That becomes a permanent unhappy feeling of yours. And that permanent unhappiness comes on your face and you become permanently unhappy for the time being, I would say. Therefore, coming out of the family, if you do not have a happy family, coming to a place where you have good friends, good teachers, teachers with positivity, physical infrastructure, which is more positive, which is more conducive, which can bring in a better life to you, is required. So therefore, I would say that if at all you have something like this around you, something like this, which is always, you know, criticizing you, pulling you down, and making it sure that you get failure, please try to get rid of those situations. You should not be get rid of those people if you can't. But that you can definitely avoid them, get rid of them. And if somebody is deliberately infusing negativity in you, deliberately infusing wrong mindset to you, I think now you are my student, you're a student of Royal Global University, where in every semester we will teach you behavioral science. We will also teach you to be happy, to be having good behavior and attitude, but also we would love to teach you how to absorb negativity, but do not emit negativity. This is also a very challenging thing to absorb negativity of the people around and do not emit negativity. And therefore, at times I tell about something from mythology, which is known to most of you, if not all of you, then some of you, and some of you will learn today. In a very simple words, I would like to say that you must be known that once upon a time, that asuras and God, both Bhagwan or Asur, both have decided the search of something called nectar, Amrit. They started churning. They have done what? I'm not going to detail of it. One side there were demons, another side there were God, and they were pulling Sheshnag and they were trying to churn the Sheer Sagar and trying to find out the nectar. But it was predestined that before the nectar will come, the wish, the poison will come. And that poison will be such a poison that will finish the whole humanity. And then this poison came, everything started dying down. It was in the ocean, so everything started dying down. So there was a lot of human cry in the universe, in the humanity, on earth. So somebody said, who can cure us from this? And it was decided that Lord Shiva can cure us, can give us relief from this. And this poison has been taken by Lord Shiva and it is still there in him till his neck. So whatever negated, little bit we can learn from mythology. I'm very fond of mythology, not only Hindu mythology. I'm very fond of Christianity, Islam, jurisdiction, and I read a lot about these issues. Every dharma, it has been said that the good people, the God, Almighty, whatever name you give, they are known for absorbing negative and emitting positivity. And it has also been said that every one of us is having little God in us. Hum sab mein Bhagwan ka vaas hai. Everybody is having little God in us. So I would request you that little God of us should become like God Shiva, another God, who should absorb negativity, keep it till your neck, and don't try to emit it out till the time it is required ultimately. It is very, very important to have some wish in you. But that venom, that wish is required at a particular point of time. And that point also comes in life. So have that, but don't unnecessarily emit it out whenever you get. So this universe is having both positivity, negativity, venom, and nectar. what you need to take, you have to decide. Dr. Rai has said, are you open, going to open a sky when it is raining with a surahi, a low neck adhan pot, or with a ghada, a huge neck adhan pot? Are you more open to learn more, or are you less open to learn more? This is all up to you, or you are just full with already knowledge. You think you are known to everything and there is nothing coming inside you and everything is going out, even if it is coming, dropping in your pot. At the same time, I would say that how open you are to get positive vibes and how open you are to learn from the system. And if you want to learn from the system, you are here from open hand. It has been said, Vidya haath jod ke nahi, haath khol ke milti. You have to ask for it. You have to, I will not use the word beg, but you need to ask. I'm using the word ask. You need to be a person who you should be filled with questions and questions every day. And every day you should ask 4, 5, 6, 10, as many questions whenever you get chance in the class or outside the class from your teachers. And as Dr. Pankaj Mittal has said, anything and everything comes in your mind, unique. You are free to ask those questions. In Royal Global University, the way of teaching is very simple with the help of RoyalNet, that you will be having lesson plan known to you that what will be taught tomorrow and maybe after 1 week from now. And teachers are expected to give you the study material for that lesson plan. Suppose there is a lesson plan called Orogeny, Origin of Mountains. So you know on 10th of October 2020 at 3:30 p.m. there will be a class of Origin of Mountains. And whatever text is required, or study material is required, Origin of Mountain, that will already be there in the RoyalNet. And you are expected in the higher education, not like class 12th education, that you are expected to read it and come prepared in the class. And come prepared in the class, not only to learn, but to challenge the teacher. Challenge the teacher so that teacher is also well prepared for the class. That higher education is more of guiding the student than teaching and learning. Teaching and learning is over for you now. Now you are in the graduation higher education, where the responsibility of teacher is to inspire you, ignite your passion and guide you whenever required. And also problem solving, whatever problems you're facing in learning, that can be solved. And if some of you feel it is not enough and you are weak in a particular subject, then we have a system of tutorial classes. You can give your name for the tutorial, then a little bit more extra efforts will be done to make you comfortable in that subject. So be prepared, because the advantage of private sector universities is that we have all these things in place. And for Royal Global University, teachers know it very well. And I'm telling you on the day 3 of orientation that there's no class go unattended. If that goes by chance, it will be compensated by that teacher maybe next day or next to next day within that weeks of time. But by and large, all classes are always conducted and being attended by all the teachers. Otherwise, we take very strict action against those teachers if they are not been able to do so. So therefore, you are fortunate that you have joined Royal Global University. At the same time, you have to learn a lot from them. But whatever I've taught, success, failure, manage your life, manage the negative vibes, manage poison, emit positivity, how it is possible? You must be thinking, this is a sermon Professor S.P. Singh is giving. Every senior person comes, gives this kind of bhashan, this kind of sermon. How it is practically possible? So therefore, I have given you two examples of my life. It is actually practically possible. This is 36th year of my life. 1984, I took admission in my graduation first year. And by that time, I was 17 or 16 and a half years of age. My father and mother, they have given me, my grandfather died when I was in class 10 and I scored well and he was very happy. I got some scholarship. He said that is the best day of his life. So I still remember those days. So when my grandfather died, I was whole soul head of the family, other than my mother, because I was the elder son. So I was become ghar budha at that point of time when I was hardly 16 or 15 years of age. But that has given me a lot of responsibility to see my sisters and brothers. And that has given me a chance also to become more responsible in life. And that was actually one of the issues when my grandfather died, complemented my little bit deviation from my studies. But then I would say that unless and until you are ready to learn more from the system around you, you will never be able to fetch more. But who could do it? This is 36th year of life. Whatever I did in my class 9, 10th, 11, 12th, and then later on graduation for continuous 12 years. Every day, it was minimum 3 hours or 2.5 to 3 hours every day. I was out of my class. I was out of my home. And I was always there in on a sports ground. At that point of time, that used to give me, that was a very big de-stressor. That was a very good part of my life where I was making my life better with respect to my health and physique, because I lost some part of my health when I, after Delta Cartel, after effects of that particular medicine, my liver got damaged. I was into severe jaundice, hepatitis A for almost 3 months. And I lost, almost my liver or maybe my whole health. And from then onwards, I decided I will never take any medicine in my life, allopathic medicine in my life. And I tell you, since then, 1984 to 2000, touch wood, God is kind on me, I have not taken even a single allopathic medicine. I'm on homeopathic at times, but that too also very rare. But then I decided that I will not fall sick and I will do a lot of things to my health and I will remain healthy. And that particular challenge, I think, have been well taken by my body. And today, and from last 36 years, I am working 12 to 14 hours per day out of my house. I have deliberately decided that every day I will be out of my house, home, for 12 hours. 7:30 to 7:30 was the time being allowed to me at that point of time by my parents. 7 to 7. Sorry, 7:30 was my first class in geology. So from 7 to 7, I was out. And still I'm out for almost 12 hours every day. So this is going on. But these 12 hours are productive 12 hours, not going out for the sake of doing. It's not that I am not fond of watching movies, more watching serials, or maybe watching cricket match, IPL. I think I am very fond of all these things. But that fondness is limited to positive fondness or positive things. I don't waste my time on unproductive things or wrong things. What I saw wrong thing maybe may not be wrong to you or maybe not in your culture. So for everybody, something is wrong and something is being learned by somebody by doing something, then it becomes good. So people sit, chit chat in the evening, they have groups, they sit on the roadsides and they chit chat, friends, everything is good. If the end result of that chit chat and friendship, end result of sitting on the corner of the road or sitting in a restaurant or sitting anywhere where you think is something productive is happening, some discussions is happening, is good for you. I think that is what I mean by positive inputs or maybe positive, positive gain. You gain positive, you're gaining positive things from your life. So if every day 12 to 14 hours, you are investing in the positive work, I think success will become very, very easy. I have not seen in my life even a single person devoting 12 hours per day for the positive activity failed in life. But now, every year, many students fail in this university. Many of my friends failed in their life. Many of my friends failed in civil services. I also failed in civil services, mains examination, twice. Twice I appeared for something else. As Sam has said, I qualified my state civil services. I never thought of joining it. Many other examinations, Air Force, everything was not a problem for me. I always was selected, but failed also in civil services. But then that failure has given me a lot of knowledge. And I think I actually not failed. I gained. I'm successful. From that failure also, ultimately success came to me. But I tell you today, in civil services time also, I have not seen even a single a person who didn't get success in life, not maybe in the civil services, but somewhere else in life, if he has worked 12 hours a day positive. So my request to you, because you are at the same stage, what I was there in 1984, you are 36 years junior to me, that you should also be devoting 10 hours to 12 hours starting with per day for positive activity. Because once you come to Royal Global University, you will start your journey at maybe 7:30 in the morning or 8, and you will reach here by 9. You will be free at 5:15. You will reach home by 6. So almost 9 hours, though, I will be taking from you for your education. And then another 3 hours, what you do in the campus, 9 hours and 3 hours more, you should be having something to do with sports, because jogging, gymming, Zumba, this is not the ultimate objective of fitness. Fitness is not only physical, it is physical and mental both. If physical and mental you want both, you have to be part of some sports. You may be playing badminton, because the best thing I learned from sport, that every day we used to have so many failures and every day we used to have so many success. If you're playing football, every day either you will fail in scoring a goal or you will score a goal. You will fall down. It's better to fall down on the ground every day than to fall down in the life every day. So these are the learnings from sports. You can learn many, many things from sports if you are passionate about it. So my request to you is that 2 to 3 hours you devote for studies, reading newspaper, watching news, as well as 1-2 hours for activities in sports. And in today's era, it is more difficult. At our time, it was easy. Why it was easy? Because that time television was just introduced and these digital devices were not there. We were not being blessed by eye-fixing laptops and laptops and mobile phones and iPads. We were not being exposed to that. So we were having more time probably to go outside. But today's time, I'm not saying go away from, you know, these devices. These are very useful devices. I'm able to interact with you because of this device. So I should not criticize that device. And I never criticized. But I always said something about it, that you should be judicious in devoting time on these devices also. Your screen time every day should not be more than, I would say, at your stage, maximum 90 minutes, 60 minutes, or extreme 120 minutes. So this is in addition to 12 hours I'm talking about. 12 hours I want you to devote for your books, your classes, your sports activity, your physical fitness, and another 1-2 hours you can devote on your digital platforms, because that is the requirement. And this makes 14 hours. The balance is 10 more hours. The 10 more hours may be 1 hour every day you require for your daily discourse. But another 1 hour, it is very, very important. What we are missing badly is you are not devoting with your family, your siblings and your parents. Here I would like to say something very important for success. That is, you should not be only intelligent. You should not be only having good mind. You should also be having good soul and good heart. If you are not good from inside, and goodness is visible, your interaction with your family members, goodness is reflecting with your way of thinking about others in the family first, and then to friends, and then to society by and large. People, many I know, they talk about society by and large. They talk, you know, they will do whatever for the nation. But you go to their home, you find a very dissatisfied home environment. The family itself is not cohesive, not having good communication, not having good vibes among themselves. How can those people make a good world around? So the peace and happiness come from you first, how happy you are, how peaceful you are, and how happy and peaceful your family is. Then it goes to community and then goes to the country. Rare of the rarest people who come out from a disturbed family. Once they're out of that disturbed family, they work like God Shiva and they keep the negativity here and they also spread good things. So I'm again not talking exceptions. Exceptions are always there. Exceptions in the form of APJ Abdul Kalam, exception in form of Atal Bihari Vajpayee, Nelson Mandela, Mother Teresa. There are so many exceptions. So exceptions are good as a motivator for you to become an exceptionally bright and good person. But not everybody will be exceptionally blessed. I know that very well. So therefore, if you're not going to be exceptionally blessed in the journey, if destiny is there that you will become exceptionally blessed, you will be. But then in the name of exceptionally blessed, you should not miss the normal blessing. And what is that normal blessing? That blessing doesn't mean that it comes from only mother, father, and the elders. No. Blessing comes from youngsters also. Blessing comes from your colleagues also. Blessing comes from your friends also. How? What is blessing? Please understand what I mean by blessing. Blessing means that somebody thinks good about you. Somebody wants that good happens to you in your life. That may be elder, that may be younger, that may be teacher, that may be vice chancellor, is a blessing. It's not necessary that someone would put your hand on your head or put your hand on your shoulder. Only then it is blessing. If this is, it is more blessing. It is more, I would say, flow of blessing from that person. But otherwise also, I'm talking to almost 500, 440 of you, but I am trying my level best to bless you. Best bless you for your life. And that may be a digital blessing. You can coin a word digital blessing, but the blessings are there. So these kind of blessings are very, very important in life. And this blessing can only be given once you are having right attitude, behavior, and you are also having a humble heart and soul. And also you are very, very concerned about everyone in the family. I give you just two very simple ways to understand how humble you are or not. You can decide. While you sit on a dining table, for example, and your mother, your father, or elder, they are serving food to you, they are not sitting with you. Not everybody is blessed with people in the family so that everyone sits together and eat. If you sit together and eat, that is the best everybody should do. But suppose you get food in advance than your mother, your father, or elder in the family. And they bring something to you to serve you and give you a bowl of maybe dal or maybe vegetables or anything, whatever you eat, chicken, mutton. And you are serving to yourself. But while you are serving to yourself and you are very hungry and you are very fond of that food which has been cooked today, at the time when you are doing serving, are you thinking that how much it is for me? Am I going to leave something for my mother who is going to eat end of the day? I am going to leave something for the servant who has cooked this food for me, or the whole housekeeper who has done this job for me? Is your concern there for the food shared in your family? If you have no concern and you are only concerned about you, you are absolutely a very selfish person. If you can't think about the person who cooked food will get some portion of that food or not. So once you are taking more, you are free to ask your mother, mother, do you have something for you to eat? Is it all what you have served here? So if she says she has enough, but you have to see at times mother in the name of love and affection for the children, she will say that she has enough to eat for herself, but she might not be having. Not all families are blessed with lots of money and lots of resources. Every family is having some kind of scarcity that starts from dining table to clothing and everything. So if you're concerned about everyone in the family, that they get good food, they get whatever you are eating, they're also getting. I think you have a kind heart, you have a kind soul, and you are being blessed by God. And if you're not blessed, my blessing to you is that you change your attitude from today. This is my first behavioral science class to all of you. But you are free to raise questions because I'm not watching any questions in QA. I'm going to finish in next 5 minutes. So my request is please feel free to ask questions. And I have seen in the question, this thing that many of you are anonymous questioner, people with anonymous name. It's okay if you don't want to disclose your name in the question answer. But I think from Royal Global University point of view, I want all of you to be courageous enough to raise question with your name. Because, you know, if you are hiding your name, there are two things are there in your mind. One is either you are having fear that what people will say if you ask many questions. I can say from my side, I'll be the happiest person if you ask 10 questions, 20 questions. With one name, I don't mind. I might not be able to answer all the questions, but as a vice chancellor of university, I will be having a repository of all those questions which you are raising in that Q&A, and that I will try to answer you in another 1, 2, 3, 4 months whenever I will interact with you. And I will pass those questions to your teachers and deans and seniors in the university so that they know what kind of questions are going on in your mind. Please feel free and don't have fear of your peers also. if somebody is raising questions, maybe a silly question, but in my opinion, there's no silly question. All questions are good questions. So please feel free to ask questions. And also, if you are fearing that some of your classmates will later on criticize you, pull you down for the question you have raised, please don't have that kind of fear at all in Royal Global University. Otherwise, you will not grow. And those kind of people who will criticize will not let you grow. Neither they will grow themselves, but some smart people will grow themselves and will criticize you, and you will be not given a chance to grow enough. So you have to be very careful about, I would say, fine tuners in your class. Fine tuners are those smart people. They themselves will try their level best to grow, but they will disturb you. You might have seen movie called Three Idiots. There are a few people who used to disturb others, not to study, then to study themselves. And even if I'm studying for my sake and growing myself in many facets of field, I will discourage you to do that. Suppose somebody has told you to become the member of the music club, and you are good in music and you want to do it. One of your classmates will come and tell you, don't waste your time in music. Concentrate on your studies. Maybe he or she is not a good singer, and he or she may be envy with you. Don't want you to be in the forefront of the music club. And in the name of actually not making you more vibrant, she or he is discouraging you. They are called fine tuners. They don't grow themselves, or at times they try to grow only themselves, and they are so selfish and they discourage others to do so. So this is a big thing that we will face. You might have faced these issues in your class 9, 10, 11, 12. Many people have discouraged you for the right things, and many people have encouraged you for the wrong things. So you have to find out that who is encouraging you for the wrong things at this point of time. As Dr. Himanshu said, there's nothing wrong and right. It is a perspective. At this point of time, what is right for me and wrong for me was not right for me and wrong for me when I was a student like you. So there is right and wrong keeps on changing with time and circumstances and situation. So I'm not going into debate of this. One day I would love to talk to you on right and wrong, but then today not Karna or Arjun, that we can decide later on. But as of now, I know, I see that all of you know very well what is right and wrong for you, for sake. And I think you all are grown up enough to understand what is wrong and right. But if you ask me to tell you what is right and wrong, I tell you, if you are giving productive 14 hours for positive activity, whatever other things, if at all, you should not do wrong at your point of time, but whatever little bit wrong is there in you, doesn't matter if 14 hours you're devoting for positive things. Why? Because whatever I'm talking about, whatever success, path to success is, that starts from your health. So whatever is to be done in your life, if you're not healthy, you are not healthy physically and mentally, you will not be able to gain that much which others will gain who are physically and mentally healthy and happy. So therefore, you should be a good absorber of vibes, positivity and knowledge. And for that, you need to be very healthy and happy. And for that, you should know and listen to your body. What do you mean by know and listen to your body? Means that you know you are not feeling well because you're not exercising. Then you should start exercises. You know very well that you're not feeling well at this point of in your life because you're sleeping too much. You're not waking up early. You're sleeping very late. You are unnecessarily watching videos or other things on mobile phones and the gadgets which are stressing your eyes. And you may be having so much, kachra in your head coming from WhatsApp and coming from Google, which is actually blocking your mind. You know. And once you know this is unhealthy, this is not giving you right kind of things, you know very well how to get rid of that also. And if you're not been able to get rid of that also, you have counselors in the university, you have people around you who can counsel you to get rid of those negative, wrong things at this point of your time in your life. So this is one, this is mental and physical health. And I have devoted 3 hours every day. You should be devoting to your physical and mental health. That may be yoga, that may be pranayama, that may be sports, that may be Zumba, that may be anything you like. But I would say one sports at least is a month, that may be chess. That may not be physical. You can play, you can do gymming for 1 hour and come back and play carom. come back and play, chess, come back and play Ludo. I don't mind. But that both sports and combination of physical exercises is a must. That is what my personal understanding and experiences. Second is, you should take off time. You should break yourself. It's just 14 hours. Every few hours, you should have break for some time, 10, 15 minutes. And you should think what you're doing. You're going in the right direction for the day. You are going in the right direction in life. And whatever is being thought in the morning to be done today, are you able to do it? Are you able to cover that? And if not, then what modification you want to do in today's plan? So this is taking off time and give yourself a perspective you need. Many times in life, when you are doing something, you get demotivated to do that. Many of you, when they will come to Royal Global University, when we are going to be very, very strict with respect to attendance, with respect to this and that. And also you are not physically fit and attuned. You may be having some crisis and problems at home. You will be frustrated. Some of you will be frustrated, I know. At that point of time, you have to think what is more important for you. Is family more important? Is studies more important or health more important? Nobody can carry all the things all the time together. Not everybody is blessed so far. So you have to prioritize. So priority giving, your priority is health, priority is studies, priority is family, priority is what? So if you prioritize your day and your life and your month and the year, I think you are more successful, because once you prioritize, you devote time and you get success. Stop making excuses and try to devote, right things at the right point of time. Excuses, as I said, in my class 12, there were many things happened, but I never have said that those were the excuses for my bad results. There, I also said that I was also responsible because my energy has been wrongly distributed for the right thing at wrong point of time. Wrongly distributed for the right thing at the wrong point of time. Please understand what I said. I said that, so this is what happened. But then I realized later on, I will not commit this mistake. So that was a good learning for me. So what probably I wanted to say, that whenever in my life later on, I scored more. In graduation first year, I scored exceptionally well. Then I decided in the second year, I will not study that much, but not so low so that I score second division again. So I decided that I will not do that much. And I devoted my time to establish, that was 1986, to establish a socio-cultural organization in the University of Lucknow called Halley's. Halley Comet came at that point of time. And that Halley's cultural group has, I would say 50% of I am what I'm today sitting in front of you, talking to you. The input comes from the socio-cultural literary organization called Halley's. There we were organizers, I was the founder chairman, and many people who are working in government of Assam, they were part and parcel of that club when I was chairing that. They are ADGP and others. So what probably I wanted to say, that I learned leadership at young age when I decided to devote more time for my club and activities than to study. So that was a judicious decision and I never regretted that. And my teachers at times, some of them used to say, you're wasting your time on this. And now they say with proud that you have invested time at that point of time on the right thing. So many times your teachers are also not very sure that what is required for you. So you know better what is required to you. And you can get counseling from there, but then you have to decide on your own. Then second is that you cannot have something which is called success without passion and hard work. Like path to success is fine, but path to success goes by these two very tough things, two roads. One is passion. You have to be passionate throughout. And once you achieve your little passion or success, you should, think something bigger and you should be passionate for the next level. So passion should be complemented by hard work. And I would use one more word, positivity. So passion, positivity, hard work. But then what happens? People want everything in life, all luxuries of life, all laurels, success, name, fame, without doing anything. This is where the problem lies. You don't want to work hard, even if you have a situation to work hard, and then you try to become the most successful people in the class and country in the world. That will never happen. If this happens to one exceptional person, you may not be knowing fully about it, then they are outliers. You should not think them as a role model. उसने तो बहुत कम पढ़ा था, वो सिविल सर्विसेज में सेलेक्ट हो गया, उसने तो बहुत कम पढ़ा था, उसके हमसे ज्यादा मार्क्स आ गए. दे आर द रेयर केसेस. प्लीज डोंट गो बाय देम बिकॉज दे मे बी हैविंग समथिंग व्हिच इज नॉट विजिबल टू यू. मे बी आई कुड माई एग्जाम्पल ऑल्सो दैट आई यूज टू स्टडी लेस देन मेनी ऑफ माई क्लासमेट्स बट आई यूज टू स्कोर very, I mean, far better than them in the end semester and examination because of maybe my power of understanding things quickly or learning things quickly and maybe remembering it for quite some time. So what are the reasons? I don't know myself. So if I don't know myself, how you know how I score better than people who are the more hardworking people? It's not only intelligence. Intelligence is complementary. All of us are born, exceptional few, are born with same kind of IQ. Same kind of intelligence, but IQ changes in due course of time. So that intelligence is same, IQ changes, EQ changes, SQ changes, all social quotient, emotional quotient. These all are the factors which bring in a complete human being. And that is possible only by hard work. And as I said, if the opportunities come in front of you, you should grab it to the extent you can do it. Don't overdo it. Do not take so many responsibilities. Then end of the day, you mess up and be stressed. Take whatever best you can take from the system and society and from the school and university and the classes and the teachers. You may be asked to become the class representative. You may be asked to become coordinator of the class. You may be asked to become a club member or maybe a convener of a club member or a mentor in due course of time. Be prepared for these responsibilities. These responsibilities are part and parcel of your university days, education. Education doesn't mean fetching good marks, that I always say, and I mean it. And you should also be, something which I'm at times criticized for. I mean, I'm confessing in front of you all, I should, because I'm being criticized to be very much perfectionist. If I want to wear this tie, I'm just giving you an example. I never thought I'll give you this example. If I'm wearing this tie, so this, my collar and tie, in the angle between this collar and tie should not be different. It should be equal. Means this angle to this collar and this angle to this collar of my tie, if it is not lying at 90 degree or 85 degree, both should be 85 degree. I mean, I'm so much perfectionist. Also, if I do anything, if I clean my house, if I clean my clothes, if I do anything, I want that nobody can do better than me. This takes a lot of toll. This takes a lot of toll, but at the same time, this gives me lots and lots of satisfaction and confidence that tomorrow, if I'm cooking galavti kebabs for you or anything, any food for you, I love cooking. This is a big de-stressor for me. I would love to cook in such a manner so that nobody can cook, even the best of the cooks in the country should not, could not find the same taste when I cook. So that is the way I am. I have been, because I think I should not left any stone unturned to make this thing the best. At times I have to compromise. I'm not saying that every time I get the perfection. At times, because of paucity of time, because of paucity of ingredients, because of paucity of people who are supporting me. I'm not talking about cooking only. I'm talking about the system. I had to compromise. And because the time is pressing, so I had to say, okay, let it go, because in the name of precision, if you are taking too much time for precision, is also wrong. So you should be having precision, perfection, but in the limited span of time, because if you do not complete things on time, the precision and perfection has no meaning and value. So this is another thing very important for you to understand. Once you lose anything in life, somebody has asked question, I have lost, if you lose your heart, if you lose something very precious to you.
Excuse me, sir. Very sorry to disrupt you, sir. We have a lot of questions.
Questions are not visible to me, sir.
Yes, sir. I've been copy pasting them in an.
I've been missing them. Oh, so sorry, sir. So I thought there's no questions. I was continuing, but I'll conclude in two more minutes. And thank you so much for telling me. It was a miscommunication because the questions were coming and flying off. So I would just, I tell you, end of the day, I mean, it is impossible to get success without right path and without precision, without hard work, without purity in your heart, without positive thinking, without having, criticism, without absorbing to criticism and negativity, and without having a humane mindset, frame of mind, and loving your parents, your teachers, your siblings, and people around you. Love and peace can only come once you are a happy man, once you are a good man, once you are a good woman, and once you care for everyone around you. I was very happy. I will conclude with this. While I was noting down the questions, when Professor Rai was speaking today in the morning and Professor Pankaj Mittal, the student on the day three have adopted this university and you have become a family, because the address of the question was, we in Royal Global University wish to know from Dr. Rai that what is the path to success. So once you have used we, it means you are me. We are together. So I conclude with this. I'm so happy that within three days, you all have adopted and you have become family, extended family, that is Royal Global University family. Thank you so much, Sam. Over to you. I'm open for questions for as much time you want.
All right. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for your motivation. Thank you for letting us know of your personal life experiences. And also thank you for the tough love. I have categorized the questions into three categories, but I think I'll start with two particular questions which I think should be answered. Sir, first is one student asked if the tutorial classes are free.
In Royal Global University, whatever we offer in the campus, that may be tutorial classes, that may be classes for different gate classes, coaching classes, net classes, they all are free for sincere student. There is a system, not for tutorial, but for other classes where we have to pay to the people extra other than the normal classes. There is a bar that if any student join and take up that course, he or she need not to pay anything. But he has to ensure, or she has to ensure, that she or he will be attending 80-90% classes. If he or she fails to attend those classes 80-90%, then he or she has to pay a penalty. So we are reverse. We don't charge. We impose penalty if your attendance is less in these additional classes. I've answered, sir, very clearly.
Yes. Thank you, sir. So another question is, if your university has a transgender student, will you treat the student equally and provide safety under the university?
Absolutely, Sam. There is nothing called gender inclination in this university. Any student, anyone in the campus belonging to any gender is free to move around. And I know many of my students are having different orientation, that may be sexual orientation and also gender issues. We have no issues. And I think I can say with proud as a vice chancellor, if anybody is thinking differently about them, they are free to consult and talk to us. And we have different committees being formed for that. We are absolutely open for any gender.
All right, sir. So, sir, I'll move on to the first category of questions, which are most direct to do with the talk today. First question, does success have time or age limit?
Yes. I told in my deliberation very clear, for me at the point of when I was in class 9, the success was bringing good vegetables for the family. I used to feel very happy bringing those small things. So I was successful at that point of time. At this point of time, I'm successful in running this institution. But again, I have put my bar higher. Maybe I have something more in my mind for next level of success. So every level of your life, success has a different meaning. Every standard of your living, success has different meaning. For a poor rickshaw puller who is having very less money, success is that he earned 200 rupees that day, or a auto rickshaw driver earned 500 rupees per day, is a success for him or her. And he may not be bothered about what Professor S.P. Singh is doing as a vice chancellor. So that is success. So success is dependent not only with time and your age and your experience, but also your strata, as I have very clearly answered initially. I'm repeating it for your convenience. Yes, Sam.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. A lot of questions on the topic of negativity. I've chosen one. So question is, sir, as you said, don't emit negativity. Does that mean always pleasing others?
No, I never said that. I said be very positive, but live with negativity. I'm repeating again what I said. Live with negativity and make a long face and grim face. Even I said animals also do that once they are not happy in a particular environment. So keep that negativity or maybe negative vibes of yours intact in you, and like Lord Shiva, as I said, and whenever it is required, and I always say use it. I also use it at times, and then many of my teachers have this kind of feeling about me, that at times I tell them very badly and I'm very negative at times. I am, but I keep that negativity for minutes, for 1 minute, 2 minutes, 15 minutes, and then it's all over. It goes back either in me or that person. And don't regret about that, because that negativity is to create more positivity in the system. Is that negativity is to more positivity. Your parents, your father comes at times, they utter they at times abuse you also. They tell you this you should not do, otherwise you will do that, I will kill you, I'll do this to you, that do to you. They are doing it, but if they're regularly doing it, all the time doing it, is wrong. But they at times do to correct you. That negativity has a positive outcome. Use it, and you all should have negativity in you. One thing I must tell you, people say when we talk about peace, we talk about violence. Violence is wrong, but anger is not wrong. And the outcome of negativity, or maybe I would say not negativity, outcome of poison what you gain from society, is very useful to make you angry. And it's very important to bring anger in front of you. Anger is very, very important part of our life. We humans have been meant for both pleasure, happiness, poison, and anger. So anger should come, but anger should be used judiciously. And anger, your body should be having that much of meditation and inclination that anger should reflect only when it is required. Anger at the wrong time is bad. Anger at the right time is required. Otherwise, nobody will be able to cut short the wrong things in the society. Everybody, Mahatma Gandhi was the most angry man on this earth. He was non-violent, but he was the most angry man on earth. The day the Britishers have thrown him out in the South Africa, that day he became so angry, and he kept his anger till this level. I will throw these Britishers out of my country. So that anger is essential in everybody's life, but it should be used at the right time and in the right manner, in the right perspective. That I always say. So negativity is important, and you should not be always happy. You should not make, but don't, if you are happy and you are trying to make a face and telling everybody you are unhappy, that is the worst thing. You should not do that. Chalo, Sam, next question.
Okay. Sir, I have two questions that I feel are very important. However, 2:45 is the time of the next webinar. We can borrow 5 minutes from them.
I hope so.
The first question I think will be quite common to many students. The question is, sir, I am not fluent in English. What can I do?
Oh, that's no problem. I was also not fluent in English, and still I am not, I suppose. I learned a lot in due course of time. Look, language should not be a bar in the initial stage. But as the medium of instruction mostly is in English in Royal Global University, also the examination, what you will write will be in English. And last year and last year, we have seen many students who have joined us. They were from the vernacular medium and they have faced few problems. But then for that matter, we have kept to a very important thing in our university. Every semester, you will be taught communicative English as a one credit course every semester. 3 years, 4 years continuously. And that communicative English is not only for verbal communication, it is also for written communication. So you need to emphasize a little more in comparison to those people who are already fluent in English, to emphasize and devote more time on your communicative English, that may be written and verbal. And I say, if you can learn German, French, Russian in 3 months, why can't you learn good English in 3 months if you are intelligent enough? But you should not fear you fear, you will never be able to learn this. So my request to you is that what communicative English will teach you is fine. Then we have language lab where you can enhance or you can make your pronunciation better. You can also, you will get a lot of chance. Even the examination of communicative English has been meant in such a manner where you are being given a chance to give a presentation regularly in the class. The presentations will be there, but you should not shy off. If you are a shy person, you will never learn English. You will never talk to your friends. But if you're not a shy person, keep your shyness away from you and don't bother about others. You will be fluent in English in the next 6 months. Over to you, Sam.
Okay, sir. So let's squeeze in one more question, quite an important question. The question comes, in life, in order to achieve our dreams, we may sometimes take some actions, but our parents might not like for the same. They may not like it. Can it be considered a success? Giving pain to our family to live our dreams, can that be considered success?
Very intelligent question. It is something, if you go this direction is wrong, if you go that direction is wrong. It's not like that. I can tell you with my experience also, many, many times parent, whatever they think about you is right, but not all the time. I'm repeating, not all the time, including my parents. I respect them a lot from core of my heart, but I did many things in my life hiding from my parents, but they were not wrong things. I'm repeating, they were all good things to build up my career. My father was a state level badminton player and he always discouraged we children, four of us, two sisters and one brother, we are total four. He always discouraged us to go for playing in the playground, sports. You know, we used to tell them that we are going for the classes, and classes used to start at 7:30. We used to say it is an extra class in the morning at 6:30. And we used to throw our, you know, football shoes and kit from the backside of our house. And we used to go out from the house, go to the back, pick up our kits and go and play 1 hour in the field. And then from field, we directly go to the class and change the clothes in between somewhere. So I also have done many things in my life, but then probably we were intelligent enough, prudent enough to understand that sports is very important, though my parents, my father especially, was saying that padhoge likhoge banoge nawab, khiloge kudoge banoge kharab. So that, but that I never agreed upon, and I told my father when I become little successful in life that you were wrong and I was right. And I think at your age, adult age, you are also have a, but then again, whatever you think is for your success, you should follow that. Even if your parents not agreeing, we will support you, I guarantee you.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. I think we can end the Q&A session. I think it was a very healthy Q&A session. Thank you, sir, so much for your time. I think we'll move on to the next webinar series.
Thank you so much, Sam. I request you to send me all the questions, and yes, I will put all those questions in my itinerary. And whenever I will be interacting with you students again, I will take up all the questions. And whenever you are in the campus, I would love to meet all of you. Because end of the day, I'm not the vice chancellor. I'm vice chancellor, tomorrow I may not be, but I'm from my heart, I'm a passionate teacher. I'm into this profession by choice, not by compulsion. And I wish to remain a lifelong teacher. And I take your classes, and I hope I would be lucky, and you may also be lucky, if we both will be found in the physical class in another 1 month's time from now. Thank you so much. God bless you all.
Now, can I start, sir?
Yes.
All right. So good afternoon to our esteemed speakers and participants of the session today. Hope you all are enjoying and enriching your knowledge throughout the orientation program organized by the university. The session now will definitely add up to your pool of knowledge. So please stay gripped in. I am Christy Saikia from the Department of Social Work, Royal School of Humanities and Social Sciences. And it is my pleasure to moderate today's session with Madam Dipanita Jaiswal, a very vibrant and eminent personality in the field of media. Ma'am will be talking on responsible leadership and the youth to gear up the newcomers for the new beginning. I welcome our eminent speakers and our dear participants to this session of day three of the RGU Students Orientation Program 2020-21. Royal Global University, Guwahati, Assam is a leading university of Northeast India committed to provide unparalleled education to render holistic development of the students. It caters to 27 schools offering 130 plus courses. RGU strives for academic excellence through research intensive and industry oriented education instilled with a strong sense of becoming a global citizen. Before we start with the session, I would like to request Madam Florence Hendrik Rabha, Assistant Professor and Head Electronic Media and Anchoring, Royal School of Communications and Media, the Assam Royal Global University, to say a few words to our participants to set in the session's mood. Florence ma'am is a prominent television personality, actor, former radio jockey, author of Celebrating Womanhood, founder and principal of Scholars Home Public School since 1986. Ma'am, may I request you to take over, please?
Thank you, Ms. Krishti Saikia, for this beautiful introduction. Very warm good afternoon to everyone. We are privileged to have our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Dr. Sanjeev Pratap Singh, sir, respected Registrar RGU Angira Mimani, ma'am, amongst us today. I can see many of my seniors and colleagues also have joined us. Thank you and welcome. So, my dear students, on behalf of the Assam Royal Global University, I welcome you all once again from the bottom of my heart. I'm feeling very, very happy to share with you that today we have with us a special guest for this session. And she is our esteemed guest speaker, MD DY365 Television News Channel, Mrs. Deepanita Jaiswal. Welcome to our orientation program, ma'am. It's really very kind of her to have agreed to interact with our new students today in spite of her, you know, busy schedule. And yesterday I could see that she was very excited when I told her about this interaction to be held with you all today. So first of all, dear students, I would like to congratulate all the freshers. I think this is the first time I'm meeting you. This is the third day of orientation program today. I believe this time we have about 800 to 900 freshers joining the various undergraduate courses in our university. And it's wonderful to have you all here in this common virtual platform. Thank you, dear students, for joining Royal Global University. I hope you all know that new students of our master degree courses will be joining us soon after a month or so. So dear students, the topic of today's session is responsible leadership and the youth. And that is you. You are the future leaders of tomorrow. And this is the beginning of your college life. Today, I want to tell you that please dream and follow your dreams. Set your goals now. Remain focused on your goal or goals. Be patient and please be ready to work hard. I repeat, be ready to work hard. Yesterday, Dr. Sanjukta Parashar also said the same things, right? So never be afraid of failures because that is the first step towards success. Be eager and be enthusiastic to learn more. Be very optimistic about everything, even though these are difficult times due to corona pandemic. And we all know, but I would like to say that this is the time and this is the age for you to gain more knowledge, learn new skills, learn life's lessons, and through your own experiences and also from your very experienced and your very efficient teachers in RGU, in Royal Global University. So be aware, we are all here to guide you. If you want to know anything or feel confused at any stage, you can always call me. Even if I'm at home, I am there for you. I'll be there for you. So students, this is the time to empower yourselves with knowledge, values, more skills, so that, you know, by the time you pass out of this university, you are well prepared to face the world, to face all the challenges in your professional careers ahead in any corporate or any organization. Remember, you also have to be financially independent after you acquire your degrees and education, because that is the first step towards total independence. Aim higher and higher. The sky is the limit for you. Improve yourself every day. Compete with yourself. Learn to become better human beings and being a, you know, good professional, a good worker every day. Learn to help each other to make progress in life. Be progressive. Never entertain any thought, any negative thought in your mind. And even if it comes, just push it away. I am a teacher, but believe me, I love to learn every day. I learn from my students, from every person around me. I meet every day. See, that's how you evolve, you grow, right? So this is the third day of your orientation program, and I'm sure you enjoyed the sessions during last 2 days also. Yesterday, we had the brave IPS officer from Assam, Dr. Sanjukta Parashar, for you. Our Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, had invited her for you all, and she is such a dynamic leader, isn't she? So today, we have another efficient leader, Ms. Dipanita, Mrs. Dipanita Jaiswal with us, MD DY365. I have worked with her in DY365 channel as a news anchor in English from 2009 to 2014. The interesting link between Dr. Sanjukta Parashar, Mrs. Dipanita Jaiswal, and me is that Dr. Sanjukta Parashar was chosen by Mrs. Dipanita Jaiswal for the very first, you know, episode of the second season of our DY365 talk show series on women achievers, anchored and scripted by me, which went on to become one of the biggest hits and a very inspiring television talk show series. It was very inspiring for all the youngsters. And later on, I also ended up writing a book on these inspirational achievers from Assam who appeared in our television talk shows. It is in the RGU library. You can always read it. So I have witnessed Mrs. Dipanita Jaiswal working and leading her team in the television channel from her office at DY365 through all ups and downs and various challenges she faces in media world. So believe me, I had a wonderful time working for the news channel. I loved my work, and when you love what you are doing, every day is a holiday for you, isn't it? So I'm glad that she is here with us today, and I welcome her once again. So my dear freshers, wishing you all a very meaningful, inspiring, productive, fun-filled learning, you know, progressive and happy college life in Royal Global University. Be attentive in your classes, be disciplined, follow all the rules and regulations set by the university. Madam Angira Mimani looks after that, all the rules and regulations, okay, and she is very strict and very calm and composed. I just admire her leadership qualities. We are so strict because sometimes we are strict because so that, you know, you become stronger when you face the outside world, you know, outside this university campus. So we want to see you as leaders and full of positivity and energy, and I know you all will do great things. I have faith in you. Trust us, trust Royal Global University. Stay motivated. Love you all. God bless. Over to Miss Christy Saikia now.
Thank you so much, Florence ma'am, for setting up the session's energy completely. I now request our respected registrar madam, Angira Mimani ma'am, to give an introductory remark for the orientation session on responsible leadership and the youth. Ma'am has done her MBA from Guwahati University and have graduated in physics with almost 30 years of service. Angira ma'am is one of the pillars of Royal Global University today. Ma'am, may I request you to offer your insights about today's session?
Thank you, Christy. Good afternoon, respected Honorable Vice Chancellor Sir, Professor Dr. S.P. Singh, Academic Chairperson Professor Alok Buragwain Sir, all senior professors, faculty members, colleagues, and dear students. It's my joy and privilege to welcome and congratulate this batch of students for joining Royal Global University and taking a step with us to fulfill their dreams. Today is the third day of this orientation program. This solemn ceremony is a yearly affair, and it marks the start of the journey of a batch of youngsters who are the future citizens and leaders of our country. You all have listened to speakers like Mr. Anil Sahasrabuddhe, Professor Ved Prakash, Dr. Sanjukta Parishar, Professor Saket Kushwaha, Dr. Pankaj Mittal, Dr. Himanshu Rai, all leaders with their cumin and vision in their respective professional sectors. We are very happy to have Dipanita Jaiswal with us today, MD of a leading media house, someone who is a leader herself, changing the face of regional television and reporting when there was none. My acquaintance with her goes back decades, And Dipannita, we would really love to have you physically in our campus during more better times. I'm also proud to state that our university has completed a number of successful academic years under the very able guidance of our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Sir Professor Dr. S.P. Singh. And let me assure you that we here at RGU are making all sincere efforts to procure qualified and skilled employees or entrepreneurs by providing you sound academic and practical exposure along with adequate stress on ethics and values. It'll also be our endeavor to make you the best of the employable citizens who can serve the nation or the region in its stride towards economic development. Dear students, you all know that a good employee plays a very pivotal role in the success of any enterprise. And in the present day scenario, his or her duties have increased manifold. It has just multiplied. The situation demands that the employee be an all-rounder, have abilities to perform under all kinds of pressure. So students, apart from your technical knowledge, you all need to be proficient in various skills, say like communication, coordination, decision-making, and especially leadership. Great leadership qualities are very much required in the present times by all organizations across the world. Now the question is, what qualities are needed to become a great leader? What leadership actually entails? Who is actually a leader in the true sense of the term? What is the role of a great leader? Now, these are some of the questions that must be in your mind. You must be wrestling with these to know the answers. Well, who better than Dipannita with her hands-on experience to guide you on the true qualities of a great leader? I'll also add from my perspective that an individual actually becomes a leader when he or she has the ability to lead mankind on the path of progress without any selfish reason. Mind you, students, that's very important. You cannot be selfish if you are a leader. So, dear students, we are very excited about your presence with us today as participants and witnessing your induction into the various courses of RGU. We are very privileged to have association of senior professors, all experts in their respective fields, who will be guiding you, providing you inputs during your journey here, and which will be extremely beneficial to you in the long run. We are also very fortunate to have the total support and cooperation of our Chancellor and Pro-Chancellor, who have always supported us and provided us the best of facilities and amenities required for grooming you in the campus. Now, finally, students, one word to know the university, particularly during these trying times. Since you all are presently in the virtual mode, I'll advise you all to visit the website, Know the University, familiarize yourself with the people, the events, the activities, etc. in the campus, as you're going to spend some crucial years with us. And we all are looking forward, hoping to see you at the earliest in our campus. Hope that comes very soon. So with these few words, I look forward to another successful and interactive academic session with you all. Thank you. Now over to Christy.
Thank you so much, Angira ma'am, for the positive remark for today's session. Well, since our very honorable Vice Chancellor, Sir Professor Dr. S.P. Singh, sir, is with us, it is our honor. And sir, we would definitely not miss the chance to hear a few words from you. So before that, sir, please allow me to introduce you.
No. Dipannita knows me well, and the students—they have been introduced. I've been introduced to them. Quite a few hours back.
Very fair.
I was not supposed to speak on this occasion, but I wanted to be present with Dipannita's, this webinar today. So most welcome, Dipannita. We are eager to hear from you, and the topic is very, very relevant. And I think this leadership, we all are sort of leaders. In a way, not political leaders, but leaders in our own domain. And I think we are trying our level best to become a better leader in due course of time. And leadership is something which we learn every day. And from the very childhood, I think I got an opportunity. My surrounding, my environment was something, family environment was something that I've been given a chance to learn leadership from the very, very early age. And that I actually have discussed with my student only 15, 20 minutes back. So I'm not going to repeat that because that will be, you know, for, it is basically for the students. But then this university, I would say that is doing very well. And I think all of you, including Deepanita and all of the participants, I can say with proud after working with several institutions in the country, we are on the right track. We will become far better than any other private university of the country, only with the support of all. That support of all means the political will, political people, people from media like you, my dear teachers, faculty members, other academic leaders of the state, and most important, the laurels and the success which my students will bring and give it back to the alma mater, the Royal Global University. So I would, these words, I would hand over it to you, Christy, back. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. It was our pleasure. I request here to the participants to kindly give in your questions in the chat box during the session. Deepanita ma'am will address to it after her deliberation. With no longer wait, I take the pleasure to introduce Madam Deepanita Jaiswal, Managing Director, DY365 News Channel. Ma'am, please give me a minute for your introduction. Mrs. Deepanita Jaiswal is the Managing Director of DY365, Northeast Premier and renowned 24/7 satellite news channel, and Junak, a recently launched general entertainment channel, all under the banner of Brahmaputra Teleproductions Private Limited. In a career spanning more than a decade, Mrs. Jaiswal had gained experience ranging from teaching to administration, holding a degree from one of India's leading colleges, Lady Sriram College, Delhi University. She had begun her professional career as a lecturer in Sonapur College. Mrs. Jaiswal was also serving at Don Bosco Institute as an academic coordinator. At DY365 and Junak, Mrs. Jaiswal is spearheading the company's aimed at making Brahmaputra Teleproductions Private Limited Northeast top media industry. Under her able leadership, the organization has been successful in upholding the ethics of journalism and gaining the trust of the masses. She is guiding the channel in times wherein the media industry is facing a lot of challenges. She focuses in portraying the truth. Mrs. Jaiswal is a passionate advocate for a clean and green environment, primary healthcare reforms and healthcare, primary education, gender-related issues, and measures to aid the underprivileged and needy, and always values any initiative or institution that sprinkles hope and brings new spark and smiles to the lives of those who genuinely makes an effort towards making their dream come true. Mr. Jaiswal, at present, is a chairperson of Indian Women Network, IWN, Guwahati Chapter, an integral part of the Confederation of Indian Industry, India's premier business association for the session 2012-2013, and had attended the G20 YEA summit, which was held in Moscow in 2013. Mrs. Deepanita Jaiswal is also currently the chair of Young India Northeast Region. Mrs. Jaiswal is widely traveled, a passionate reader and a painter with an admirable insight in both news and entertainment sector. Ma'am, I request you to take over for your deliberation. It is a pleasure to have you with us today.
Thank you, Prissy, for introducing me so well. And yes, it has been a pleasure to interact with the freshers here, the newcomers. And no doubt, like talking to you people and talking to such luminaries is equally enriching for me. So should I start now? Good evening. Yes, Dr. Professor Dr. Singh and the Vice Chancellor of Royal Global University, thank you so much for the invitation. Mrs. Rabha, I know my connection with you goes way back and we are more of friends than anything else. And Mrs. Mimami, I have known you since my childhood, I can say that. And you all are my inspiration too. And my dear Christy, thank you for coming and moderating this talk with me. And my dear students, well, what can I say to the students? These days, they are much, much smarter than us. But yes, since I have been given the responsibility to speak on this responsible leadership at youth, wow, the word is very, very heavy, no doubt. But then, yes, that is what we are. We are responsible. We are the leaders. You all are the future leaders, and you all are young and dynamic. That's what is it all about. You have to be the drivers now. You all are the future leaders of our country. Should I start? Now what it says is that, what I feel, whenever I talk to the youth, it makes me feel young again. And it inspires me equally. I feel so inspired every time I talk to any young generation. My generation, at times I feel that, yes, we are kind of stuck. But the youth have got so many ideas, so many things. They are so adventurous. My God, I can't say. And this is one thing which really inspires me every time. I am here today talking to the future hope of our country and the world as they are embarking on a new journey, which will further shape their life. Your energy, your dreams will add new flavor to not only our community, our country, and also the world. Dear students, you are at the threshold of a new and exciting phase of your life. Trust me, college life will not only be challenging, it will also sharpen your perception and vision. Not to forget the excitement of making new friends. Don't you think so? All the youth will be looking forward, all the, you know, the bubbling. No doubt you all will be now meeting each other in the virtual world. Virtually also, I think you all are very expert in this. Making friends in all the game boards and everywhere. Y'all don't hesitate. So this is the new chapter that is beginning in your life. So charge it and take it up as a new exciting journey for you. Let me just come to the leadership factor. How will I define a leadership? Can we call anyone a leader who doesn't have a sense of responsibility? No, definitely not. A leader without a sense of responsibility cannot be a leader. So there has to be a synergy between a leader and responsibility. I may become a boss, yes, of any organization because of my qualification. But does that make me a de facto leader? That is a question that comes up. A boss and a leader. There's a marginal difference between that. I came up with a very interesting caption today, which kind of I wanted to share with you all. A boss orders, go to his juniors. Whereas a leader will say, let's go to his or her team. That go and let's go. You know, the difference is very minute, but if you notice us, it is immense. So here comes the difference between a boss and a leader. See, the word boss itself sounds very heavy, doesn't it? So you feel, yes, you're the boss. Okay, it's very heavy. But a leader is much more subtle, and a leader is all-encompassing. Florence, ma'am, has asked me to speak a little bit about how I evolved to become a managing director of DY365. Here I go with my evolution process. Well, let me start one thing. Before joining media, I was also in the same profession as you all were. I was a lecturer in a college, Sonapur College. I was teaching logic and philosophy. I think, yes, logic makes you more logical. Philosophy gives you in-depth knowledge. So that was my subject. Teaching is still very, very dear to me. And my husband and my children, they still tell me, stop your lectures. So I'm still a teacher, basically. Not to forget that. I can never forget the day when I went for my college interview. You know what? I was a girl who passed out freshly from Delhi University. And here my father told me, okay, there is an interview in a college. Would you like to go and attend? It was just hardly 2 months or 3 months. I just returned back. I said, why not? Let me give it a try. So there was a walk-in interview. I walked in to the interview. And just to gain experience, I said, okay, let me have a feel of it. And let me just gain some experience. Fortunately, lo and behold, I was offered the job. The moment my initial excitement, I was initially very excited. I informed my father I got the job. Then soon it gave way to trepidations. You know why? Because I had to teach in Assamese, which I had studied till grade 7, and that too as a second language. And teaching college students in Assamese was a challenge that I thought, can I do it? Will I be able to teach? And I thought, why not? Let me give it a try. I did learn. I can still read rudimentary Assamese. Why not? The first thing I did, I bought a dictionary, English to Assamese dictionary. And I embarked on this responsibility of teaching, which I continued for 3 years. That was my first job as a teacher. This taught me how to read and write in Assamese. Then, you see, not only that, I was a teacher. I was teaching logic in Assamese. I was teaching philosophy in Assamese. Along with that, I was a student too, because I was learning from them also. I'll tell you one small anecdote. I did not know the meaning of kukura. Okay? And that time, my teachers who were helping me out, they were not there. So I went to the students and I said, listen, there's this word called kukura. What is it called? And they told me promptly, ma'am, it's murgi. So I said, okay, fine. Now I know what it is. And I went ahead with it. That's how I was a student along with the teacher. So that was how I taught. That is how I learned also. Then came my next opportunity, when my children joined kindergarten. I just walked in to Don Bosco Institute one evening. I still remember Father Thomas was there. And I said, see, I'm free from 9 to 3. If you have a new job, you can give it to me. So he said, yes, I have the job of academic coordinator. I said, fine, I'm ready for it. And I did not know ABC of what I am going to do. So I just landed up with the job. There I learned how to make presentation, prepare a course, coordinate with the other departments, and put it on the table, as well as take it to a logical end. So that was my, you know, career. That's how it started. Then my husband, one fine day, came up and said, now you have to run a news channel. Here I was sitting on the seashore, enjoying. Suddenly I was thrown in the deep sea. My option, either I swim or I sink. I had no other option. I decided, okay, let me give it a try too. First 6 months, I used to sit on every table of each and every department to learn electronic journalism. Here I was a student managing director. Yes, I was a managing director. Again, I was a student. I, in fact, kept on bombarding my team with thousands of queries till the time I understood the nuances of electronic journalism. It took me 6 months. Now I can say that sitting in my chamber, looking at my screen, I can understand whether they're doing the job properly or not, whether it's going on properly or not, or whether they're missing.
Christy, I think we lost the connectivity.
Yes, yes, sir. Should I call Dipanta ma'am?
Somebody should call. Yeah, somebody should call and get it fixed quickly.
Florence ma'am, I'll give a call to Dipanta ma'am.
Rishti, I can call her if you want me to.
Ma'am, please do. It's her internet connection. Yeah, it has to be her connection. She got lost.
These are the challenges we face in virtual platform.
Indeed, but it is also getting hassle-free, you know, from the start till now.
Yeah, it was. It began very well.
Yeah. She's trying. She's trying to come back.
All right.
I think these are challenges, and we are going to come out very well out of it.
She's there.
Where was I? I was talking about my evolutionary process, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Were you in the process of either sinking or swimming?
Okay. So then I started swimming and I evolved myself. Now, dear students, the reason that I'm telling you all this is never say no to any challenges or opportunities that you face. If I would not have taught in Assamese, I would have been in no position to run Assamese channel and Assamese news channel. If I would not have been a academic coordinator, I would never been able to coordinate the different departments of my channel. Every job taught me and made me what I am today. Learning is an ongoing, never-ending process. Till my last breath, I will remain a student. Yes, I'm still in your classroom. Not to forget that. Coming back to responsible leadership, dear students, in order to be a leader, apart from having the required qualification, there are a few soft skills which makes a leader in the true sense. Should I enumerate a few of them? Communication is the first skill. If you can't communicate, we can't lead our team. They have to understand in clear terms their responsibility and what is expected from them. Next, knowing our team, we should know each and every member's strength and weaknesses. Who is best suited for which job and then delegate accordingly. That is a very important component of any leader. Respect is another factor. Mutual respect is very important. Without it, no team will give their best. I stress a lot on empathy. That's why sometimes I'm called too soft too. But I can't help it. Empathy is very important for me. We have to be able to understand any problem that faces our team and with empathy try to sort it out. There are many other factors also which I would like to add. Integrity, ethics, courage to take decision, vision, capacity to listen and take feedbacks. Other factors which will make a leader earn his respect and be dependable. Last but not the least, a leader should never stop self-evaluating. This is the only way to growth and progress. Team development and self-development have to go hand in hand. Otherwise, we can never achieve our goal. Be that leader, dear students, who is leading from the front and also watching his or her team's back. Without that, our team will fall apart. In China, I read in one article, there are coaching institutes for future CEOs, where from the very childhood they are trained. there, more than IQ, EQ is valued. You know what is EQ? EQ is how you communicate, how you relate with your members and with the other people in your team. People with high EQ are considered to be better suited for CEO jobs. In India and all over the world, also, leadership programs are training our future leaders. The health of any organization depends on its leader. If the leader is lacking leadership qualities, the organization cannot survive. It'll just fall apart. Dear students, you all are our potential leaders. You have it in you. You are our hope, our flag bearers. Be inclusive. Be the problem saver. Be the risk takers. Engage in such projects which will bring positive changes. Work towards sustainable development and be socially responsible. A society is banking on you, is depending on you. Don't be afraid of failures. Failures are great teachers. I believe I failed more than I have succeeded. It makes you more resolute. Then only you will be called a responsible leader. I would like to wish all the dear students and everyone in Royal Global University best wishes. And God bless you all, always. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to speak with you all. And it has been a pleasure to have you all interacting with me. Thank you once again.
Thank you, ma'am. It was really a crisp session from you. It was really nice to hear from you, your journey, and everything that you said about the skills that are required to be a responsible leader. Indeed, very true. I hope the newcomers to the university have, you know, gripped this, and they will take it with them throughout the journey in the university and after, for their greater good life. Well, ma'am, with this, I move on to the Q&A session, if you allow me to.
Yes, please.
All right, ma'am. Ma'am, I'm taking up a question that came to me before. It's India's political leadership is far removed from ground reality. What are its effects and how can it be corrected?
See, as far as politics is concerned, the dynamics of politics is very different from what we imagine. Right? We are basically, what I feel is that when the future of our country is dependent on the leaders who are politicians, it is up to us to choose the right leaders because we are the one who's responsible for bringing them to power. If we fail in choosing the right leaders, we can't expect our country to be in the right direction. So choose very wisely, vote very wisely, see which leader will give you the best and who will be serving you truthfully. And that is where our role as the citizen is very, very important because we are responsible for giving them that power, giving them that reign to run our country. So it is us. We have to take a call and choose the leaders.
Thank you, ma'am. It was more of a question from your perspective to understand how politics work. Anyway, the next question is, do you believe that leadership can be cultivated or it is by birth? If it is cultivated, how can it be cultivated?
It can be cultivated. Let me tell you this. It can be cultivated because one thing which I feel I have seen in my experience, I have seen many students or many people whom we have landed up. We have thought that yes, that person can't do it, but he proved that he or she has proved us totally wrong because he or she worked hard to come up. Basically, it is how you work hard and how you develop the leadership skills. As I have said in my talk also, the soft skills. Mm-hmm. is very important for a leader, because ultimately you're leading a team. And a team needs your suggestion. They will look towards you for guidance. They will look towards you for any issue that comes up. You should be there. And that you can learn, you can do. And if you are confident, you can definitely become a leader.
Thank you, ma'am. We are getting a lot of questions in our chat box. I am taking the first one, which is quite very contextual. So this Jayesh Gowri from BBA, he says that I love to take up responsibilities at any time when asked. But there are some hurdles, like collaborating with other leaders or in charge, or conflict with event management team, etc. So how can I overcome hurdles while taking up the role of leader?
See, hurdles are a part of life. If you don't have hurdles, then how will you be able to be challenging? These are challenges. See, every situation, you have to, you know, kind of measure the situation. And you have to understand how you're the other person who's, you are saying, a leader, and whom you want to, you are seeing that something is wrong, how you can win him over. You have to learn to win that person's confidence. So winning over is another thing which is very important. The moment you win, it's not always you say, I am right. It is how you make the other person believe that, yes, you are right. You can't say, I'm right always. We are none of us. Even the leader is not perfect. My team member, many a time, they point me out that, yes, I am wrong. There are other things, there are other points, which is a better way of putting it. So it's always here. A leader has to listen. A leader has to give opportunities to a team to grow. That is how a leader is. A leader cannot say that I am the leader and you have to be a that you have to listen to me. Then what happens? You become the boss. So that is the difference.
So we got a question like this, which I have already tapped you have already answered, ma'am. So to be an answer, you need to be a dictator or need to be a team member. That was the question. So you have already answered that in the flow of your deliberation. So I think that question got answered. Well, another question now is, what are the qualities required to become a successful journalist, and what are the hardships faced by females in the media industry?
That's very dear to me. This topic is very dear to me. See, hardships is there in every profession. Every profession, without hard work, you can't be successful. You have to be ready to work hard. It may be journalism, it may be any office work, it may be anywhere. Without hard work, no profession will give you the best. You will not get the best out of it. Now, coming to the point, journalism is one thing, because what I feel about journalism is that there are a lot of expectations, because we are the medium. We are the medium between our people and the government or whatever. We are the messengers, basically. So as a messenger, your responsibility increases manifold. You should not become like the Chinese whisperer that ultimately turns out to be something else. So whatever is the fact, whatever is the truth, we have to bring that in forefront. Coming to the woman journalist, look at me. I was not a journalist. A, I learned everything on job. B, I am now leading one organization with my team. Let me tell you this. I have a very able team. I'm just kind of giving them ideas, a little bit of direction. That's it. I'm a woman too. So if a woman, with her grit and determination, thinks that she can do it, whether it's journalists or whether it's in any field, I don't think so anyone can stop us. Right? Does that answer your question?
Indeed. In the previous session, our VC sir already said this, gave a statement that there is no, gender thing in the university. You know, we do not look into a person from that perspective. So it's a free wall. It's a equal platform. You just need to grab your opportunities, throw out your best, and there's no woman, man.
Yes, exactly.
In grabbing opportunities, of course, there will be hardships in every profession.
Exactly. True.
Well, ma'am, another question that a very teenaged mind question, very nice. That what is the first step that I can take to set myself up for success when I start a new leadership role? The first thing to do. How do you go about it?
The first thing, the moment you think that yes, you want to become a leader, isn't it? The first thing that you have to know is that you have to identify your team. And if the team accepts you as a leader, then only you will be a leader. So how to make the team accept you as a leader? You have to have a little bit of an edge where they can depend on you. Here comes the question of the sense of responsibility, the sense of duty. And they know that any task given to you will not go unfinished. You will take it to the logical end. That is how you build your team. And that is how people, your team members or others will know that, yes, I can depend on him or her as a leader. That is the first step, I feel. Building your trust.
Thank you, ma'am. That I hope it got the question got answered. Another question here is that since you addressed this emotional quotient thing when you gave your session, so this one question is quite familiar to that. Handling wants as well as the emotions of others is extremely crucial to be a successful person. Can you suggest some ways of effectively dealing with that or doing so?
See, when it comes to emotion, it becomes case to case. Mm-hmm. Let me tell you this. I can't react to one person in the same way as I will react to another person. So you have to understand the situation at that point, what the other person is seeking. Sometimes a person will come to you crying. Sometimes a person will come to you angry. Sometimes a person will come to you agitated. So these are the different situations, case to case, and you have to handle it accordingly. You have to understand like why, the reason behind her, him or she, the person crying or the person becoming angry or the person, getting agitated. You have to understand the reason behind it. Mm-hmm. Then only you can sort out. You can't equally react. So that time you should be the pulling person, the composed person, and try to work out how to solve their problem. The moment you start solving their issues, helping them out in their issues, you solve to a great extent the entire organization's issue too.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, I think you have already, you have said this point very much properly earlier, that how some of the skill sets like communication, empathy, integrity, ethics, these are few things that helps you to understand a person in your organization closely, and that creates a good platform. Well, thank you, ma'am, for that. Ma'am, the questions that I'm getting in chat box are some of them are overlapping, so I'm combining all and asking it. So another question here is, ma'am, do you think that a woman should compromise with her dreams, only taking into consideration the expectation of the society from a woman?
No. No one should compromise on their dreams. Yes, you can timeline it sometimes, but don't compromise on your dreams. Because if you compromise on your dreams and your aspirations, you no longer remain a whole person. You're like crushing yourself. Never, never compromise on your dreams.
You have to timeline, you have to prioritize at times, no doubt about it. But don't let go. That is not how it is. Because I feel the moment you dream, you have to have, you know, take it to a point where you can make it a reality. And that is for everyone, whether it's a man or a woman. No one should let go of the dreams.
Well, thank you, ma'am. I think you're getting we are getting questions of this aspect because you were a leader for the cohort of women here. So this is a very contextual question.
Can I just come in, Prishti?
Of course, ma'am.
I just want to ask Dipani something on the lines of the questions going on. Dipanita, you agree that mostly I personally feel that women always work under double pressure than men, mostly because of various responsibilities we have. Now, when we are talking of media, like your field, that is that working conditions are very different from the other offices.
True.
In that case, women have to cope much more, I feel. So what do you say about it, the pressure, the... and how they cope with it. Can you just tell us a bit about it so that our students, our female students, they feel more happy about
it? Sure. I take my inspiration from Ma Durga's 10 hens. I think every woman has got that. You cannot see the 10 hens, but it is there, right? So we have the capacity to multitask. We have the capacity to, you know, kind of timeline it, manage our time. We manage our time accordingly. Yeah. Yes, at times it becomes difficult. I'm not saying, and that happens with everyone. Suddenly some situation arises and you have to attend to it. But time management here becomes very important for us because we have to look after our home, we have to look after our office, we have multiple responsibilities. That is where a woman's strength comes into play. That is where you have to awaken your latent 10 hens. So that is when we awaken that 10 hens and we are ready to go.
Very well said.
I also have a question. Dipanita ma'am?
Yes.
Can please. I ask you a question?
Sure.
I'm asking you from my experience. Have you ever felt any kind of gender bias in... we have many girls also in this group, right? Girl students who will be joining media, maybe, you know, and the corporate world later on after their education. So have you ever faced any gender bias in the, you know, working field? And somehow I felt that there's also a lot of, you know, rivalry. So how do you overcome that in media? I have also faced it, you know, in my work life in the industry. Yeah. And thanks to your support and, you know, the support of my family, I could overcome every challenge every day. Oh. Every day was a struggle. Every day was, it was never easy, ma'am, let me tell you. Yes. I still remember. But I loved my job and I knew you were with me to support me so I could go ahead every time. So how do you overcome as a woman?
See, I don't encourage this thing, but there are issues. You can't deny it. Gender disparity is there. You can't deny it. But I definitely, as far as my organization is concerned, I don't encourage this at all. I put my foot down. I will not encourage anyone feeling sidelined just because of the gender. Capacity and capability is a different story. But just because of gender, one can't say that he or she can't do it. I don't believe in that. So as far as my organization and anywhere I see this, I don't at all encourage this. And I make it a point of telling everyone that I will not encourage this. And just because A is a woman and B is a man does not necessarily mean only B can do it and A can't do it. Yes, for safety concerns, certain times I do take a little bit of precaution. Like when it comes to a night job where they have to go somewhere to a field work, being a journalist, sometimes you have to go absolutely to some raw places. There, it is not a question of gender. It is a question of safety.
Yeah.
Then I would rather say that, okay, a man should go. because of the safety concern, not because she can't do it. I have sent many of my girls, reporters and everyone to the field at the time of riots also, because I knew that they were able to handle it. But let me tell you one thing, each and every member's safety is also my concern. I have to look into that. So gender parity is one of my first and foremost, you know, look at this thing. I don't encourage this at all in my organization.
I know that, ma'am. I know that. Thank you. Thank you for answering my question and wishing you all the best. And
thank you.
And so good to, you know, hear you actually.
Pleasure is all mine.
You know, in the education field, we are still very, it's better kind of, I would say, you know, sometimes in media, it is really challenging, you know, it's really challenging. So I enjoyed it. I love it. I still do it. I'm still in the industry, but I love it. And there are many challenges.
You're still involved. You're still involved with us.
So, ma'am,
yes, tell me, Christy.
She's multitasking. She's involved with us, with you. So she's totally multitasking.
She again has an 8 in 10 hands, which comes out every time.
All inspired by you, ma'am. Inspired by Angira, ma'am. Inspired by you. Thank you.
Everyone
I see young girls working so nicely like Christy. I feel very inspired.
Thank you.
Pleasure is all mine. Well, ma'am, all the questions that we are getting now are related to the field of journalism. So one last question, I'll wrap up with that. So do you think today's journalism is on the correct path? Are today's journalists free to speak their mind and provide us uncensored news? That is the question now.
I think censorship is important because if we don't filter a little bit, the society will be in a chaos. So I don't believe in creating a society which will lead to a... You know what? We have, these days, what I have been noticing is that we are less receptive and more reactive. Mm-hmm. You know, journalism is very important for us. And journalism, doing journalism is a great, great responsibility. We have to receive the information. We have to know that whether giving this information will actually benefit the society or harm the society. Certain times, yes, we have to censor a little bit because of the better good of the society. And there's no harm in doing that. I think everyone has got a filtration process. We also have RO waters. Mm-hmm. So if we do that filtration, it is for our betterment.
Healthy society, I guess. No healthy society.
So, does it answer, Christy?
Yes, ma'am. Completely. It answers it. The question completely. Thank you so much, ma'am. I think all the questions of the participants here got answered. I have attended to every questions here. I have combined some questions. I have not, addressed it individually to make the session get done in the timeline.
Yes.
So thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. And it was a pleasure. It was a pleasure to hear you and to see you. Thank you so much to be with us. Florence, ma'am, you would like to go ahead with the vote of thanks?
Thank you. Thank you. It's okay. Christy, you can go ahead.
All right.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everyone. So I would like to